good morning as we have come to the end of May. I think which month we're in right this moment, but as we've come to the end of May and as we anticipate the beginning of June, I would ask that you be in prayer as a church family, as God would lead us to the right time and the right way to resume having our worship services. Those have not been forgotten about. And while we are not yet in person worshiping, we are connected in worship this morning by the Holy Spirit. Be in prayer about that, because we want to make sure that we do it the right way and we do it in a way that everybody remains as safe as possible, but also walking by faith and not walking by fear. Be in prayer for our nation as we go through this difficult time, and be in prayer for everybody who has been affected by the situations that I'm sure that you have been watching lately on the news. Also, a reminder to please continue to mail in for now. Please continue to mail in your tithes and offerings. Those of you who are doing so, thank you. For those that may not always remember, please put that on your phone or on a list that you can see and say, please, remember to do that. That is very helpful during this time. Also, for those who are part of our listening and viewing audience that are watching perhaps live or may watch later as it's been recorded, I want you to know that you are also welcome in the house of God. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to the book of the Revelation, Revelation chapter 1. I will begin reading with verse 9. I will be reading from the New King James Translation as we are resuming our mini-series, if you will, or our ongoing series is a better term, looking at Jesus as he is presented in that first chapter of the Revelation. Beginning with verse 9, I, John, both your brother and companion in the tribulation and kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ, was on the island that is called Patmos for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a loud voice as of a trumpet saying, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last. What you see, write in a book, and send it to the seven churches which are in Asia, to Ephesus, to Smyrna, to Pergamos, to Thyatira, to Sardis, to Philadelphia, and to Laodicea. Then I turned to see the voice that spoke with me, and having turned, I saw seven golden lampstands, and in the midst of the seven lampstands, one like the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the feet, and girded about the chest with a golden band. His head and hair were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were like a flame of fire. His feet were like fine brass, as if refined in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters. He had in his right hand seven stars. Out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was like the sun shining in its strength. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. But he laid his right hand on me, saying to me, Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am he who lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And I have the keys of Hades and of death. May God bless the reading of his word this morning, and let us join together in a time of prayer. Let us pray. Gracious Father God, we thank you for the day that you have given to us. We thank you for the beauty of this day. We thank you, Father, for the sacredness of this day and hour. Help us to join our hearts together, Lord, as a family of faith. And for those who would be watching and listening in, Lord, who are not perhaps members of this church, but worship with us nonetheless, Father, help us to join together as the family of faith, Lord, to lift up the name of Jesus Christ. Father, we ask that you would forgive each of us of our private and personal as well as corporate sins this day. Father, that our worship would not be hamstrung or hindered, but Father, that it might be honest and holy before you. Father, we pray for the anointing for Brother Gary. We pray, Father, that you would give your word success in the hearts and minds and lives, Father, of every person who hears it and, Father, who would heed it. We pray, Father God, for those, Lord, who are affected by the distress that our nation is having, not just with the virus, but, Lord, with the other crises the stress that is ongoing, Lord, even as we speak. Father, we pray that peace would prevail. Father, we pray for all who are affected. And Lord, we ask for your mercy, your grace yet again. And we ask this in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. There is joy. Attention to Revelation chapter 1, as we'll be resuming kind of where we left off a little bit about the image of Jesus, what some Bible professors have called the inaugural image of Jesus. It is the key image that is found in Revelation chapter 1. It is that image which, of course, helps you to begin to understand other parts of that book. But I've always believed that if Jesus is lifted up, that he, through the Holy Spirit, will draw all people unto himself. And in a day such as today, as we continue on into this world that we're living in, if ever we need an uplifted, an exalted image of Jesus Christ in our hearts and lives and in our church and community and in our nation, nay, even in our world, it is now. The hands of Jesus. Last time we talked about the arms of Jesus. Well, let's look at the hands of Jesus. The hands of Jesus remind us he holds all things, including our lives. A hand is a very personal touch. A person's hands are distinctive. They tell a story. They hold the story of a person's life and livelihood. It's been said,
He that is God gave each hand a unique identity. No two sets of fingerprints are the same. Each hand has five fingers, four are weak, but the addition of a thumb provides strength, an illustration of grace. My grandfather's hands were distinct. They were calloused and cracked from a lifetime of use and evidence of hard work. His hands were big and they were full of strength. He worked through the Great Depression. He served in the United States Army Air Corps in World War II. Then he served as a grocer, a salesman for Archway Cookies, a convenience store owner, and lastly as a foreman for Mississippi Steel and Iron. And in retirement, those hands were never idle. With them, he ran a gas station for the local co-op in Canton. He gardened relentlessly. Long, hard hours poured in to gardening. And he used those hands to build or to repair many a thing as needed. Those hands held the books that he loved to read, the Bible that he read and studied, the pen and paper by which he could eloquently express himself. And those hands crafted little sailor pirate hats out of newspapers for me when I was a young child. Those hands would also go on to bring me donuts and bags of gummy bears when I was at work during my high school years and even into my early college years when I worked at a local nursing home and hospital. Those hands worked on many a lawnmower, and many a time those were the hands that held mine. His hands told the story of a man of faith, fortitude, and family. They told a story of love. The hands of Jesus, they tell a story. The hands of Jesus revealed in graphic terms that he holds all things together by his hands. That he has your life and my life. He has our life as a church family. He has our community, our state, our nation, our world in his hands. The hands of Jesus reminds us that they hold all things together. When John was on the island of Patmos, now I believe that the John that is revealed in the book of the Revelation is the Apostle John at a later stage of his life. That would explain perhaps the more rough use of the Greek language. There are other Bible scholars who say it is a different John, and that may be the case. We really have no way of knowing, but we know this, that ultimately it is the Holy Spirit who has inspired this revelation. It is the revelation of Jesus Christ. It is from God through Jesus, communicated by God's angel, and ultimately given to John for the seven churches. And as such, it is God's word for us today. But as John, as an older man, and I'm going with the apostle, if I'm mistaken, so be it, but I don't believe that I am. John, the apostle, who was imprisoned for his testimony in the Lord Jesus, for his preaching and pastoring, most likely at the church of Ephesus and other similar churches in the region, has been exiled to this rocky island in the Mediterranean Sea by order of the Emperor Domitian, who has begun and initiated an empire-wide persecution of the church. It was not a fun time. It was not an easy experience. And yet God in Christ saw fit to use John, and especially John the Apostle, for the most significant aspect of ministry he would ever know. And John sees this image of the resurrected and glorified, exalted Jesus. And it overwhelms him. He's on his face, so to speak, as if he's a dead man, terribly afraid. When you encounter the holiness of God, fear is always a wise response. And it says in that verse, "And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. But he laid his right hand on me, saying to me, 'Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am he who lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And I have the keys of Hades and of death.'" I want you to note this morning, number one, the hands of Jesus are strong hands. Strong hands have power. In Bible times, references often made regarding the right hand. James Newell states that the word hand appears 1,800 times in Scripture, 500 times it is literal, and 1,500 times it's used in a figurative sense. Hands are associated with activity. and with ability, and undergirding that would be authority. As such, it can be a symbol of power and of strength. Newell also states that the hand of God is an idiom, a way of expressing or referring to the supreme and the almighty power and authority of God. So that right hand is not just a general definition to let you know the right from the left, or if you're watching it, it's probably right and left. It depends on how you look at it from your perspective on TV. But with that said, in the language of the New Testament, it is the word care, and the word, and the scholars tell us it is the instrument used to accomplish purpose. And I promise you that Jesus then and now is full of purpose. The Bible says, "Of old you laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the work of your hands." Psalm 102, verse 25. "And the high priest answered and said to him, 'I adjure you by the living God that you tell us, if you are the Christ, the Son of God.' Jesus said to him, 'It is as you said. Nevertheless, I say to you, hereafter you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the power and coming on the clouds of heaven.'" Matthew 26:64. Exodus 13:16. "For by the strength of hand the Lord brought us out of Egypt." The hands of Jesus are strong hands. God demonstrated his presence and power in that Exodus event against Pharaoh on behalf of his people Israel. He brought them up. He brought them out of Egypt, ending their slavery by his own power, because there was nothing that they had, no ability, nothing that they had of their own inherently that could have ever delivered themselves. If that had been the case, they would have been up and out long before 430 years had passed. But they were dependent upon the power of God. And it says, by his hand and by an outstretched arm, he delivered them. This idea of power. There was nothing that Pharaoh or the court of the Pharaoh or his sorcerers could do about it. In the context of the revelation of Jesus to John on the island of Patmos, this image of Jesus is one of glory and of personal involvement. The glory of God that laid John prostrate at his feet, and the very intimacy of putting that hand maybe on John's shoulder. "Don't be afraid. I am the first and the last. I'm the one who was dead, but I'm alive, and behold, I live forevermore. Amen. And I have the keys to death and Hades." Personal involvement. "He had in his right hand seven stars." Revelation 1:16. "This is the mystery of the seven stars you saw in my right hand, and of the seven gold lampstands." The seven stars are the angels or messengers of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches. Revelation 1:20, Jesus had and has in his hand, in his possession, the seven stars, the angels, those messengers, those pastors even. He kept or preserved them. He directed them. The word angelos, the scholars teach us, can mean angel or messenger, which is why I reference the term pastor on that. The spiritual beings, as angels, were often used of God to convey messages and to conduct ministries or missions. And yet they also can relate to those pastors who were called to be shepherds of the communities and shepherds of the congregations that they have been entrusted with. Dr. Kendall Easley, a Bible teacher, says, and I quote, "I believe John's main point is that Jesus sovereignly held these persons in his protection and care." The hands of Jesus, those hands are, as I have emphasized and will emphasize again, they're strong hands, and strong hands have power. But how do we apply that this morning? Jesus then and now has power, and all that such a term would imply. He has power to mold, power to shape, power to fashion his church, and individually your life and my life, our family lives. We, as it has been said in the book of Jeremiah, and as we would say today and beyond, we are the clay. When I was at Holmes Community College, my first year in college in 1988, I was in industrial education, at least for a semester and then changed my major. But during that semester, I had to take some industrial education courses. And one of those courses I took, it was kind of like an introductory course. We covered a wide range, had some carpentry things that we did. We had some other kind of like a Votech type situation. And so we actually had to deal with some pottery and clay stuff, have actually done that. Pouring it and fashioning it, even put it in a kiln and fire it, then go back and paint it and then shellac it and all those things. Let's just say that I saw early and I saw quickly that no, that was not what God had called me to do or to be, was industrial education. You live and you learn. But one of the things that I saw was how that you mold and shape that clay. And our life is like that in the hands of Almighty God today. He is that potter. And he has expertise. He can and he will mold and shape this church. He can and he will mold and shape your life and my life as he wills it. The question we ask ourselves and one another, are we ready, willing, and able to entrust ourselves to his powerful hands and to the process by which he uses those hands in our life? Those times where he puts that right hand perhaps on our shoulder, spiritually speaking, saying, don't be afraid, I've got this, I'm with you. Or sometimes that maybe putting that left hand on our shoulder, saying, hold up, wait a minute, no further, let's walk through this together, don't get ahead of me. Or those times where he has us in hand saying, I've got you, and because I've got you, I will not let you go. Jesus then and now has power to uphold his chosen leaders so that they can and they will seek his face to do his work and function as shepherds of his flock. As we go through this time together as fellow churches, as we go through this time together as fellow pastors and ministers of all shapes and sizes and kinds, that he has us in hand. He has us well in hand, and he has you and me well in hand. I've said it before, and guess what? I'll say it again. Who has the Lord entrusted to your care today? You think about that. It may be loved ones. It may be friends. It may be other family members of some kind. I don't know. It may be people that you are responsible for in your job or career. Will you place them and yourself into his hands so that he can help you? The hands of Jesus possess power this day to save and to secure that salvation, both corporately and individually. Thank God that our salvation is not dependent on you and me. If it was dependent on me, we're sunk. If it was dependent on you, we're doomed. If it's dependent on us, well. But praise God, he has that well in hand, and nothing can snatch that or you or me out of his hand. To uphold and your continued progress and your continued prospects, spiritually or otherwise, Jesus has his hand on it. There's an old song, I don't know all the words, but a friend of mine taught it to me at my previous church many years ago. He has his hand on the throttle, thinking about a train going full steam ahead. Jesus is that conductor, but he also has his hand on the throttle. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. John chapter 10, 27 through 30. The hands of Jesus have power to save you in every way today. Yes, to save you from hell so that you miss hell and make heaven. To save you from a life of sin and degradation. He has the ability to save you from the types of dangers that sometimes are all around you and you're not even aware of. He has that power not only to save you from the negative, but to deliver you into a new way of life, into a better way of life. Put your hand in his hand. There's another gospel song. Put your hand in the hand of the man from Galilee. Well, that's a pretty good statement. But I also would want you to recognize he's more than just the man from Galilee. He is the Son of God. He is the Savior of the world. And in his hand, there is power. There is strength. There is hope. Will you put your hand in his hand today? President Franklin Delano Roosevelt was the 32nd president of the United States of America, and he issued a series of 3,522 executive orders. That's quite a bit. His first came on March the 6th, 1933, when he declared a bank holiday, forbidding banks to release gold coin bullion, kind of a shutdown for everybody to catch their breath, reorganize, and then to reopen. Has his actions step to address what was called the Great Depression and was getting worse. Already was 4 years in by the time he became president. The president was able to execute and to enforce federal presidential authority, having a wide range of power that might not otherwise have been accessible, but during a time of crisis was. A wide range to be able to accomplish political, economic, military, and judicial objectives. That's what an executive order is. So too the hands of Jesus have that authority and that ability to accomplish and administer the will of the Heavenly Father, and of that will as it relates to the people of Almighty God as well as to the world as a whole. He has that power. He is that power, and he has that power well in hand. Strong hands also not only have power, strong hands have a purpose. Christ has purpose and a plan for his bride, the church, that she might be his agency upon the earth in this present dispensation for the furtherance of the gospel, for the spread of kingdom work. He has purpose and purposes to present her to himself in a special way as that bride, special adorned, it says in Ephesians chapter 5, Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it that he might sanctify it and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. That is his purpose for your life and my life. That is his purpose for Chunky Baptist Church. That is his purpose for our sister churches. That is his purpose for the bride of Christ, of which you and I are a part. Newell goes on to say, God used his hands to uphold and guide the righteous. That has not ended after 2,000 years. Psalm 37:24 says, the steps of a good man are ordered or established by the Lord, and he delights in his way. Though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down, for the Lord upholds him with his hands. There is purpose in the hands of God. Psalm 139, verses 5 through 10, you have hedged me behind and before and laid your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain it. Where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend into heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, some translations say hell, it is the abode of the dead after physical death. Behold, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost part of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall hold me. Praise God. In the context of the revelation, Jesus, the image of Jesus holding the seven stars, whether it be the angelic beings or more likely, or perhaps in conjunction with both the pastors, the messengers of those churches, in his right hand, walking in the midst of those seven lampstands. It radiates purpose, particularly for the Ephesian congregation. I know your works, your labor, your patience, that you cannot bear those who are evil. You have tested those who say they are apostles and are not, and have found them liars, and you have preserved and have patience, and have labored for my name's sake, and have not become weary. Nevertheless, I have this against you, that you have left your first love. Revelation 2:2-4. Jesus had the ability and the authority to say to the Ephesian church, you've got some good things going on. And he affirmed those good things. They had been one of the premier churches, a series of house churches or congregations that made up the Ephesian church. In fact, the letter to Ephesians written by Paul under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit is a circular letter that would have been read in each of those house churches. And for such a long time, and Timothy, I believe, may have ministered there for a season. Obviously, John. And so it was a near and dear church. But over time, they had kind of just gotten into a routine, just going through the ritual. They had left or lost that first love. And so Jesus had the authority, because sometimes people don't always realize, hey, I'm just in a rut. I'm just kind of doing the same old, praise God from whom all blessings flow, amen, and just keep right on going, when the Lord is saying, well, hold up, stop. Let's get back where we need to be. Return and remember where you were, and remember how you've fallen, and then get back where you need to be with me. And he gives us the grace to do that. And I'm not suggesting that any of you or us are in that capacity as the Ephesian church. I'm using them as an example, but we are reminded how that I would rather have somebody come and say, well, hold up before you go any further. Wait a minute. I would rather have that than to keep going and barreling through and make a disaster of it. Jesus went on to reveal the corrective action the Ephesian church needed to take. It involved remembrance, repentance, and a quick return. His purpose was redemptive. He wasn't telling the Ephesian church, if you don't shape up, I'm going to zap you. Now, he did tell them that if they did not do so, that he would remove their lampstand. I know of nothing worse, nothing sadder, and nothing scarier than for any congregation, anywhere, any place, any time, to lose its influence for the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why I believe that in this, and I hope to it sooner rather than later, post-coronavirus world that we are eventually emerging into, that the church will have more influence, not less. Pray to God that where we as his people need to remember and repent and return as he would direct us by his hand, oh God, give us the conviction and the courage to do that, so that we may be that influence, especially in times and places where the church must be the conscience of the nation, where the church must be the conscience of the state and not the other way around. Jesus did not want to bring the judgment to bear. Rather, he wanted them to be in right fellowship with him. His purpose was redemptive, that Ephesus would not have to experience the divine discipline. Revelation 3:1 says, these are the words of the one who holds the seven spirits of God. There's a way you can understand that, because some people might be talking about seven Holy Spirits. We could spend a lot of time addressing this verse, and this is more of a devotional look than it is kind of being deeply exegetical. But just for a moment, there's at least one or two ways to understand that verse there before we go any further with it. Number one is that seven being a perfect number is a way of saying, here is the Holy Spirit in his, who is God. The Holy Spirit is never an it. The Holy Spirit is a person. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. One God, three separate persons. This is a mystery, you bet. Are we going to be able to explain it to everybody's satisfaction this morning? Probably not. But that's how God's Word shows us. It is a reality, and therefore we accept it, and we accept it by faith. With that said, one Holy Spirit perfectly manifesting himself in these various ways, these seven spirits. Of course, you can think of the seven fruits of the or other offices of the Spirit. In other words, a multi-task, a multi-purposed situation, but one Holy Spirit, which is what I lean towards. Some have said, well, it may be referencing using that word, the seven Holy Spirits, in that in essence that God is allowing the churches that are in Revelation to have a share in what is going on in a part of his will, and through extension, you and I can do that. That's probably a very accurate understanding as well. William Barclay talks about that to an extent. It says, these are the words of the one who holds the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know your works, your deeds. You have a reputation for being alive, yet you're dead. Revelation 3:1. Jesus addressed this to the church at Sardis. He commanded them to be watchful and to strengthen that which would remain, to be repentant. His purpose for that church, for that congregation, was to be clean, to be healthy, to be productive, to honor him. Therefore, he would honor and bless them, equipping and empowering them for that. His hand guiding them, his hand saying, I've got this. His hand saying, oh, whoa, hold up, no further. His hand saying, you know, here's some things. Let's look at it this way. Sometimes you actually have to put your hand on somebody's shoulder, kind of turn them a little bit in order to get them to see, especially when I've been trying, or when I was younger and my grandfather would try to show me some type of shooting star thing in the sky. I would look everywhere in the heavens but where he wanted me to look, and he'd look right there. Can you see it? Usually I didn't. Sometime in the year 1972, my family and I went to New Orleans to the French Quarter, to my favorite place, the Café du Monde. I'm talking about the one on the French Quarter itself. Now, there are some franchises scattered about, which are the same, but I don't know. It's just something about being at the riverfront, at the what I call the real Café du Monde. I learned that in those early days, it was not uncommon for them to make a day trip. We wanted coffee and beignets. New Orleans was a few hours away. You get up early on a Saturday morning, you drive down, you have coffee, beignets. Then at lunch, you eat someplace, and then you head home. That was awesome. They also like to go to the Morning Call Cafe, which was or is, unless it's closed, I doubt it, in Metairie. If you really want an excellent hot chocolate, Morning Call's the place to go on that one. A little shout out there for them. There's a picture, an actual photograph of my grandfather holding me with a death grip, around, not by my hand, but by my wrist. He likely had a strong vice grip on me to ensure that I did not get away and run loose into the crowd at New Orleans, into that melee of people, or more likely into the traffic that even then could be kind of scary. I remember that trip. It was 1972. I was young, but I can remember it. His hand was to protect me from falling on the sidewalk and curbs or other things that might hurt. And all these relevant pictures of that 1972 trip, he had me well in hand. A hand that could have a powerful pull when he needed to exert it. Been there, done that. I know what it felt like for him to have a vice grip on me. The same hands that could lift me up and put me on his shoulders for a season. The hands of Jesus offer strength today. The hands of Jesus offer support today. The hands of Jesus offer security today, as we need it more than we ever need it. His hands convey purpose today. He has rich purpose for the life of his church, and thus for you and for me today. Like the psalm writer David, we can trust his hand to lead us and to guide us whithersoever he would want us to go, and to do whatsoever he would want us to do. Take him by the hand. He would want us to take him and hold by that hand. He's got a vice grip on us. In the language of the Old Testament, the Hebrew word is chesed, I believe. I believe that's right. Chesed, that is that grip of God's grace, the kind of grip that will not let you go, the faithful love of God, that kind of love that is not ever going to be changed by whatever you say, think, or do, or whatever you don't say, don't think, or don't do. It's the type of love that upheld Abraham both in his good days and in his not-so-good days. That is the same love that is expressed to you and me through the hand of Jesus Christ, through the hands of Almighty God. In our world of today, will you and I let him take us by the hand? He's already present with us. He is Emmanuel, God with us, and by implication, God for us. Will we take him by the hand? Will we allow him to have his grip of grace on us? Because surely we need it. When we walk hand in hand with Jesus, we find that clear deliverance and clear direction that we need, so that we can live purposeful and productive lives. God does not desire for his church just to kind of wing it on the fly. He does not desire or delight in his church just kind of make do and survive. Now, surviving's good. I'd rather survive than not to survive. But why survive when you can thrive by the grace of God? Take him by the hand. God empowers us. These trying times do not define us. No. The trying times that we live in, they are opportunities for us to identify even more with Jesus Christ, so that he might reflect his light, his life, his love through us into our communities that desperately need that witness that there is a God. And as I have said before in other situations, paraphrasing a preacher from a long time ago, that God is still on the throne and prayer changes things. Let us take him by the hand as we walk together into a post-COVID-19 environment. Let us take him by the hand as we help to pray and deal with, as we have opportunity, if not in our immediate context, but as the church in a national context in this time of great stress and division. Let us take him by the hand so that he might direct us whithersoever he will, in whatever capacity. Christ is who defines us. It is Christ who defines our times. He has us and our times in hand, and he has them well in hand. Lord willing, next Sunday we'll be looking at the hands of Jesus, because there are some other aspects about the hands of Jesus that I think are important. But as we come to this moment, as we come to the close of this particular service, the question is, have you taken him by the hand? His hand is outstretched to you today. You will find an open hand, not a clenched fist. You will find a hand that is battle scarred, so to speak. It's hands that have been crucified, pierced by the spikes for your sin and my sin. Have you ever taken him by the hand in simple childlike faith, saying, Jesus, I don't understand all the theology or all the Bible, but I know that you love me, that you paid the price for my sin, that you died on the cross, that you rose again, and you did it for me. I'll take you by the hand because I love you and I trust you and I want you to be my Lord and Savior. Have you taken him by the hand today? If you have not, I urge you, I beg you, I plead with you, nail it down today. Make that decision where you are, whether it's in the comfort of your home or watching somewhere else on your phone, or however you may be able to watch this message. Ask Jesus to be your Lord and Savior today. To all others, because I know not what decision may rest upon your heart and in your mind, and yet the simple question is this: whatever that decision may be, whatever challenge that you may face, whether it be financial or emotional or mental or health or some other, even a physical situation or maybe a spiritual situation that I have not even broached, but whatever he would be presenting before you today, will you take him by the hand? Lord, I can't see ahead. It's too dark, but you can. I'm not sure on what's on the sides of me, and I'm not really certain what's behind me anymore, but I know this. I know that you're beside me, and I'm going to take you by the hand. I remember when I was a child at home from time to time, you know, being in the house, it would be dark, but I always felt safe and secure if I knew my grandfather was close by, or especially if I couldn't see and he would, you know, here, take me by the hand. I will help you, you know, make sure you don't hurt yourself or something of that regard. Jesus takes us by the hand. We may not see clearly ahead. We can't go back, and either side is maybe uncertainty, but he is that rock of security. Take him by the hand. Ask him, Lord Jesus, help me to take you by the hand, knowing that you've got a vice grip of grace already on me. If you make that decision today, whether it's for salvation or some other decision, let somebody know that. Let us know at Chunky Baptist Church of your decision. We would love to help you to mentor or disciple you, to lead you to the next step, especially after getting saved. The next step is to identify with Jesus as your Lord and Savior, and that we celebrate with you together through believer's baptism. I would encourage you to let us know that. But we'll bow for a word of prayer at this time of invitation. Gracious Father God, I pray, Lord, that each person who's watching and hearing, or who will watch and will hear later, Lord God, I pray that you would help them to consider, do they have you by the hand today? Lord, I know that you have us by the hand. You have us well in hand. Lord, help us to trust you and to take hold of that outstretched hand. Father God, I pray that you would guide us and lead us. Lord, I pray that you would use your church and direct us by your hand in the way that we should go. Father, in the things that we should do, in the words that we should say that would come from a redeemed heart. Father God, that you would use your church across this nation, Father, to be the conscience of the state, to be the conscience of the nation. Father, that you would bring those who are hurt and those those who are divided and those, Father God, who are angry, Father, together, I pray, Lord, let your grace and mercy prevail. Use your church in this hour as you have been using your church in this time of COVID-19. Continue to use your church, Father God. Direct us by your hand. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. By his grace, go with God.